Hello, praise the Lord. What a wonderful week it has been hosting and having Sister Rita with me here. This is David Wamimbi again from Palavini Christian Center. Sister Rita, you're welcome.
Thank you, Pastor.
It's been a wonderful time. It's been a blessing to have you again this week. And
thank
I believe our viewers have been exceedingly blessed, and we thank God for you for coming to share with us those insights. And so, to bring it to a close today, we want to look at two aspects of the fruit of the Spirit, and that is gentleness, or other people call it meekness, and then we shall talk about self-control, and we shall be done for this week. And so, to start with, I wanted to say that when we talk about gentleness, which is also translated meekness, it does not mean weakness. Now, some people misunderstand gentleness to be weakness. No, it is not weakness. It is humility and thankfulness towards God and a polite and restrained behavior towards others. So when we talk about gentleness, it is not weakness. It is actually, somebody says, it is what? It is instead strength under control.
Under control.
That's what we talk about. That's what we mean by gentleness or meekness. The Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 5, that let your gentle spirit, your gracious and selfishness, mercy, tolerance, and patience be known unto all people. The Lord is near. Yes. So today I wanted us to look at this aspect of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit. Actually, Jesus, the speech we read in the other scripture, in the other message, he says, come and learn from me.
Yes.
For I am lowly and gentle of spirit.
Of spirit.
So we as Christians, we should emulate and imitate our Master, Jesus Christ. And so I just want us to look at some of the qualities of gentleness, and I will ask maybe Sarita to share with us some of the qualities of gentleness.
Okay. Gentleness means trusting God.
Mm.
Yeah. Because, like we said, the opposite of gentleness is anger, the desire to revenge. It is being agitated about a matter. But when you choose to trust in the Lord, then your emotions are put in control.
Okay.
Yes. Because you've given them unto the Lord, and then, like we said, He will give you peace, and so you'll be able to settle in your heart. It also means submitting to God and everything that He says. Again, instead of being troubled, instead of being angered, instead of being, you know, agitated about the issues of life and maybe with other people, we are supposed to submit to God at all times. No wonder the Bible says that submit to God and resist the devil. So many times we are busy chasing the devil when we ourselves are not submitted to God. Yes. So we have to submit ourselves to God, to His Lordship. You may feel like punching somebody's head, but what would Christ do? Yes. So you submit to that truth of knowing that, okay, how many times has God punched me for the things that I've done? Yes. And then we need to follow Christ's example.
Yes.
Of what gentleness and meekness is.
Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, again, we say we have that character in us, we have that seed in us of gentleness. You know, you shouldn't be agitated by everything that happens around you.
Yes.
Some people think that to express a point, they have to be so loud, they have to be, you know, so aggressive. You can state your point, you can emphasize what you're emphasizing, but still in a gentle way.
And you know, Pastor David, the opposite of the verse we read in Philippians 4:5, the opposite is foolishness. Actually, the King James Version says, let your reasonableness be known unto men. So the opposite of being reasonable is being foolish. Yes. The situation may be out of control. It may be so bad. But don't be foolish. Be reasonable. Okay. And that means you need to act by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Yes.
So have some sense.
Have some sense.
Even if, you know, when you are tempted to react, first reason, some first think. I mean, in the Bible we have a man, Moses.
Yes.
He's one of the examples that the Bible gives us as a meek person.
Yes.
In Numbers 12, verse 3, the Bible tells us that now the man Moses was very meek above all the men which were upon the face of the earth. And yet he was a great leader.
Yes.
He was a great leader and yet gentle and gentle at heart.
Mm.
So you don't have to be so aggressive or so rowdy to be a leader. Mm-hmm. You can be gentle but still be a very successful leader. Because
yes.
Moses was. Mm. So if all people ever hear from you a certain word of rebuke and criticism, and it is never properly balanced out with words and actions of love, kindness and gentleness, then after a certain period of time, they will start to pull away from you as a leader.
Mm.
So that means that as a leader, our actions and our words must not be expressed from a point of view of gentleness.
Yes.
And love.
So meaning that if all the time the vibrations I'm getting from you are, you know, anger,
uh-huh.
you're rough, you're aggressive, I'll keep myself distance.
Yes, yes.
I'll stay in self distance.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Just go in self mood.
Yes.
Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, gentleness means trusting God.
I mean,
things are moving around, things are not just well, but you trust God and remain still.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, also it means submitting to God and allowing God to reign.
Yes.
You know, and the reason why people will quarrel and exchange words and because they don't trust God to handle for them their situation.
Maybe you've been cheated.
Uh-huh.
You've been taken advantage of.
Mm-hmm.
Should you be foolish in the way you act? You need to be reasonable, like we said.
Ladies and gentlemen, so let's be gentle. Let's exercise gentleness in the way we handle issues of our lives. If gentleness was exhibited in our lives, then the fights and conflicts and all these things that happen in the world, we will not be seeing them.
Paul
says some of the things should not be even heard amongst us. So, and that's the reason why we still hear all these fights and all that is because of lack of gentleness. So let's move and probably close with the last aspect of the fruit of the Spirit, and that is self-control.
Yes, self-control almost goes, they walk together.
Mm.
Self-control works together with gentleness.
Gentleness, yes.
You cannot be gentle if you don't have self-control.
The two
work together.
Mm.
And so we are looking at self-control as the ability to control oneself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm using the same word to define.
Yeah.
It involves
to restrain.
Being moderate, being able to constrain yourself, the ability to say no to the desires of the flesh,
yes.
The ability to resist temptation.
Mm.
Yes, that is what we may look at as self-control.
Mm.
In other words, actually, self-control is against
the
works of the flesh.
Yes.
That is what self-control is all about.
Mm.
Yes. Like we see in Galatians 5:19-21, it says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which so do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Yes, so as long as you're ruled by the flesh, you don't have room in the kingdom of God, because like we've read, we are supposed to walk according to the Spirit, because that is the life that God has designed for us.
Okay.
So anything we do outside the Spirit of God is flesh, and it has no room in the kingdom of God.
Okay.
Yes.
So actually what I'm seeing is that God has given us dominion over our flesh.
Exactly.
we cannot say, auntie, you know, God, you also understand the flesh. As a child of God, God has given you power. He has given you His Spirit so that you have dominion, so that you are the one directing the flesh, but not the flesh
directing you.
Great. Yes. So with the residence of the Holy Spirit in your life, we have the ability to say, to do things, not being led by the flesh, but by the Holy Spirit. Yes. We have control of our lives because when the Holy Spirit is there, He will help us to control the flesh.
Yes.
I mean, several times, you know, somebody will abuse you, somebody will do something on her, and you want to revenge, you want to retaliate, but somehow your mouth will become heavy, somehow your tongue get tight, and you
are back.
God is teaching you self-control.
Yes.
That somebody will hurt you, somebody will offend you, but you don't have to revenge. You don't have to pay back.
Yes.
You don't pay back for evil for evil.
Yes.
And when you look through the scriptures, Jesus is our perfect example, by the way,
yes,
of self-control. The first thing we see is that when He had prayed and fasted for 40 days, the enemy comes and tempts Him and says, if you're a child of God, command this story. And He had the power, He had the ability,
yes,
to do whatever the enemy was, to turn the stones into bread. I mean, didn't we see Him multiply the fish and the bread and people ate? Mm-hmm. We saw it. He would have done it. But He restrains Himself. He knows that is not the will of God.
Yes.
Not because He was weak, not because He never had the ability to do that. He had the ability to do it.
Yes.
But He just controlled.
He restrained
Himself from doing it. Again, we see when He was, actually, this one I'll read it, in Matthew chapter 26, verse 52 and 53. This is when they had come to arrest Him during the time of before the crucifixion. The Bible tells us in verse 52 that, but Jesus said to him, put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and He will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels? Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So you see that Jesus had the opportunity. Mm-hmm. You know, some of us want to use every opportunity that comes away. But it is self-control that says, no, hold yourself, says you can let other people go, let people see, and you step back and allow things to happen. Jesus had the opportunity to call the heavenly angels to come and fight for Him, but He never did it because He knew whatever was happening was the will of God.
Yes.
So when we lack self-control, we will jump out even of those very things that are God's purposes for our lives.
Yes.
It takes self-control to stay
and
remain faithful to God. I mean, look at David in the Bible. He was being persecuted by Saul. And he had every opportunity. God had given him every opportunity to kill Saul. But David restrained himself. Says, I will not touch the anointed of God.
Lord,
he restrained himself. He had self-control.
Mm.
He did not pay back evil for evil. Even when the younger man who killed Saul came to bring the news to him, actually David got angry that why did he not fear to touch the anointed and killed him instead.
Mm.
So that is what we call self-control. Mm-hmm. Self-control controls and checks ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And it also says no to self.
Yes.
Self-control doesn't seek self. Mm-hmm. It restrains self, actually. Self-control disciplines and masters self, like we say.
Mm-hmm.
And it holds and commands the self.
Yes.
You know, it is possible to stand and say, you flesh, you are not going to do this.
Yes.
You are not going to go there.
Yes.
You are not going to watch this thing. You are not going to say this word.
Yes.
It's self-control.
I like an example that Pastor Eunice likes using many times.
Yes.
She will say, stand before the mirror and begin talking to that person in the mirror and tell that person, you're a child of God.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to rebel against God.
Uh-huh.
You're not going to do things that are not pleasing to God. Talk to that person in the mirror.
Yes. You speak to yourself because God has given you control over the body.
Yes.
He has given you dominion and power over the body.
Yes.
Master it.
Yes. Because, Pastor David, have you even ever thought, like me, that if I was God, I would have destroyed this world? I mean, one little thing happens and you feel like I would have smashed this world. I would have blown it in a minute.
Mm.
Yes. But even God Himself cannot do that. Yes.
He sees evil things happening in this world, but He restrains Himself.
He restrains, yes. And maybe because we are still in the flesh, there are things that God will not allow us to do. Because if He gave us that permission to be able to do them, we would have destroyed each other.
Definitely.
In as much as we are supposed to dominate, because of our sinful nature, we still have a battle.
Actually, when you talk about those things, I mean, God can give people power and authority. That you can just stand here and point a finger and people will die.
Yes.
But if you don't have self-control, it is like getting a gun loaded with bullets and you're giving a child.
Yes.
Who doesn't have self-control on the, or not in themselves?
Yes.
They, whatever, a small mistake like this, they
will shoot their brother.
They pull out a gun and shoot and kill. Yes. So you find that people abuse the power and authority of God. So that's why sometimes God will not release as much authority and power for us to exercise them, because when we do not mature in that area of our lives, when we don't allow the Holy Spirit to help us develop self-control, then we are not yet ready to lead, to step into certain places and certain authorities.
Yes. So how do we grow into the place of self-control? How do we develop, how do we exercise self-control? We need to begin with Christ. One thing that I've come to know and realize is that when we got born again, God did not kill anything. There's no hormone in us that He killed.
Of the flesh.
Yes. There's nothing. We remained as we are. So it is up to you to make a decision. Do you want to submit to Christ and live a life that glorifies Him? Or you want to submit to the flesh? You're in charge of your life. You're in charge. God has given us the right, the permission to make decisions and make choices. So we need to begin with Christ by allowing Him to master us, to conquer us, and then we'll be able to have self-control. Then we need to pray. The Bible tells us in Matthew 26:41 to keep actively watching and praying that we may not fall into temptation. So prayer will help us. It will empower us to be able to resist the flesh. And then we need to monitor what we take in. Somebody said that garbage in, garbage out. So what you feed yourself with is what you will release. What is it that you're feeding yourself on? Are you feeding yourself on the Word of God, or you're feeding yourself on something else that does not empower or build your spirit man? Yeah, we'll read that in Psalms 101 verse 3, where David says, I'll not set no wicked thing before my eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me.
Yes.
So you have your phone, you have your computer, you can look at pornography.
Yes.
It's up to you. But you can make a decision and say, I'll not look at anything that does not honor God in my life.
That's true.
Then we need to stay busy with God.
With God. I don't mind.
It's a workshop of the devil.
Yes.
So be engaged with things that, you know, glorify God. Fine, I mean, go for evangelism. Like now we're in Corona, but I'm not saying you announce.
No,
you can go visit somebody, talk to them about Christ. Yes, find the best way to use your time. Don't be idle, because the devil will make use of your idle mind. An idle mind is still space for the enemy to utilize.
Yes.
Then we need to say no, like you already mentioned, Proverbs 25. Verse 28 said, like a city whose walls are broken down is a man who does not control his temper. Yes. So you need to say no, no, no at all times to your flesh.
Well, we cannot exhaust everything, but I want to say thank you so much to Sister Rita for such a wonderful time. I believe you have been helped, you've been edified. I pray that you will take these things and apply them into your life. What interesting thing is that you are not going to seek them from afar.
Yes.
You already receive them when you receive the Holy Spirit in you. They are residential in you.
Yes.
Your work is to cultivate them, practice them.
Yes.
Allow, the more we learn to yield to the Holy Spirit and obey Him, the more the fruit of the Spirit will begin to grow in us. This is what will make a distinction between the children of God and the world.
Yes.
This is the mark of a believer, the spirit of, the fruit of the Spirit.
Yes.
And so we pray that God will help you, and the Holy Spirit will continue to work in you, so that you may become that very person. Actually, because that image, the fruit of Spirit, gives us the totality of the life of Christ.
Yes.
When you have the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit grown up in you, then you are you have the life of Christ grown up on you, and then you're a mature Christian.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you so much for being part of this Bible Nugget this week. We hope and pray that it has been a blessing. And I once again, Sister Rita, thank you.
Thank you so much, Pastor David, for working together with me. And above all, I want to thank God for our senior pastors.
Yes.
Pastor Wilberforce and Sir Okumu.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for giving us the opportunity to serve.
Yes, sir.
And to grow in the Lord.
Amen.
Yes.
Thank you so much also for being part of this platform. May the good Lord bless you. So we shall meet again. Hopefully, as God helps us, whether we have Sister Rita back or someone else, but we shall still continue to move on to look at something else as God will put in our heart. We love you all. Regards from me and my wife and the whole pastoral staff here. We love you and we are praying for you. We know that God still reigns. May God bless you all. Bye for now.